All right, good morning, church. Welcome. It is so good to see you guys this morning. Welcome to those who are joining us virtually on the live stream. We're going to take just a moment as we begin this morning, whether you're here in the room or whether you are joining us from home, we're going to take just a moment in silence to prepare our hearts to worship the Lord and ask the Lord to work among us this morning. So let's do that, and then I'll lead us in prayer. Father, would you graciously open our eyes to see you as you are this morning? Would you reveal more of your glory to us? Help us to know you more, to know you better. We want to be awed by your greatness and by your majesty and by your holiness and your power. And Lord, would you remind us of how good you have been to us as your people? Remind us of who you are to your people. Help us to see your grace and your mercy, to remember what you have done for us in the gospel in Jesus Christ. And then would you lift up our hearts and unite our voices to respond as you deserve. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand. We're going to read this morning and really be guided in our service by Psalm 33. We're going to sing our way through this psalm. And the psalm begins by telling us that praise befits the upright, that worship is the normal, right, appropriate response of those who are counted righteous in Jesus Christ, those who the Lord has rescued. And then the rest of the psalm unpacks for us why. And there's lots of reasons, but for our purposes, I'm kind of thinking about it in just a few categories, broad categories that we're going to sing through this morning. It's because of the greatness of God. He is the all-powerful, almighty creator of all things, who rules over the earth and the heavens, who rules over the kings and kingdoms of the earth unchallenged. He's worthy because he has rescued us. He has saved us when no one and nothing else could save us and we could not save ourselves. Our God has become our salvation in our life. And he's worthy because he has turned his eyes and turned his heart towards unworthy people like us. And he has poured out steadfast love on us, and he has forgiven our sin, and he has given us himself, where the Bible tells us there is fullness of joy in the presence of God and in knowing God. So he's worthy because of those things, and we're going to sing our way through that passage. We're not even going to take a break. I'm going to read Psalm 33, and then we're going to sing three songs that just take us right through these truths. So let's read together. This is the word of the Lord. Shout for joy in the Lord, O you righteous. Praise befits the upright. Give thanks to the Lord with the lyre. Make melody to him with the harp of 10 strings. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully on the strings with loud shouts. For the word of the Lord is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness. He loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the steadfast love of the Lord. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, and by the breath of his mouth, all their host. He gathers the waters of the sea as a heap. He puts the deep in their storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spoke and it came to be. He commanded and it stood firm. The Lord brings the counsel of the nations to nothing. He frustrates the plans of the peoples. The counsel of the Lord stands forever, the plans of his heart to all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people whom he has chosen as his heritage. The Lord looks down from heaven, and he sees all the children of man. From where he sits enthroned, he looks out on all the inhabitants of the earth, he who fashions the hearts of them all and observes all their deeds. The king is not saved by his great army. A warrior is not delivered by his great strength. The war horse is a false hope for salvation, and by its great might it cannot rescue. Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him, on those who hope in his steadfast love, that he may deliver their soul from death and keep them alive in famine. Our soul waits for the Lord. He is our help and our shield, for our heart is glad in him because we trust in his holy name. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you.
All creatures of our God and King, lift lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. 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 Let all things their Creator bless, and worship Him in humbleness. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son, and praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. 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 All your redeemed washed by His blood, come and rejoice in His great love. In power to reign, heaven and earth shall join to sing. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Banners shall fall on bended knee, all creatures of our God and King. Oh, praise Him. Fall on bended knee, all creatures of our God and King. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Now
In darkest places I will call. Incline your ear to me anew, and hear my cry for mercy. Could I come before your throne? Yet full forgiveness meets my gaze. I stand redeemed by grace alone. I will wait for you. I will wait for you on your word. I will rely. I will wait for you. Surely. Has paid the price that all who trust in him today find healing in his sacrifice. That all who trust in him today find healing in his sacrifice. I will wait for you. I will wait.
Father, we do stand here in awe of you because this is true. What we're singing about is true, and it's unshakable. Lord, so we wait for you because you are the King of all creation, because you're the one who has reached down and rescued us when nothing else could be our salvation. The one who we had sinned against and offended, the judge, the righteous judge, actually reached down to us in Christ to rescue us from sin. We wait for you because you just continually show steadfast love and mercy to us. Because, Lord, you do satisfy our souls with yourself, with the only thing that actually satisfies them. So we wait for you, and we stand in awe of you, and we pour out our souls in thanksgiving, Lord, recognizing that we do not deserve any of this. And yet this is how you continue to dispose yourself towards us. So we thank you, Lord, for loving us. Thank you for loving people who were unlovable and unworthy of your love. Thank you that because Jesus is worthy, now we are counted worthy. Because Jesus is righteous, now we are counted righteous. We confess, Lord, that we struggle to believe that these things are true. I struggle to believe that these things are true of myself. There are lots of things that we know are true, that don't always hit our hearts and that don't always hit our lives. So we confess that we struggle to believe, and because of that, we struggle to obey and to follow as we should. Sin indeed so easily entangles us. But Lord, I pray that you would fix our eyes on Jesus as we've sung the word, as we're going to hear the word preached, and then as we're going to see the word and touch it in communion. Would you fix our eyes on Jesus so that we throw off the sin that so easily entangles, so that we believe the gospel. We believe the things that we're singing and that we're praying and reading and that we're preaching. And then we pray, Lord, that you would conform us to the image of Jesus as we fix our eyes on him and as we believe what's true about you and about the gospel and what is true about ourselves in Christ. Would you help us to live that reality out, to be more and more conformed to the image of your Son, that we might bring you more glory. As always, Lord, we want to remember another church locally, and today we want to pray for Community Bible Church in St. Augustine, for their pastor, John Ringo. Thank you for the faithful gospel work that they're doing in St. Augustine, and we pray that you would continue to bless them, that you would work in them, Lord, to behold the glory of Jesus and to treasure Jesus and to worship Jesus and follow Jesus the way that it deserves and the way that we're called to do as your people. So would you work in them even this morning as they meet and as they gather? Make much of Jesus as they worship, and change them, conform them as well to his image for your glory, and then release them for mission to make and grow more disciples of Jesus. We pray that you would continue to do the good work that you've started in us as we hear from your word. We pray that you would use Matt and that your spirit would use and apply your word to us, Lord. Help us to believe it and change us by its power. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, as we do just about every week, I want to take just a moment to remind you of some ways that you can partner with our church through financial giving. Not because we want to pressure everyone into giving our money, but because this is one of the ways that we do get to work together and work together as a family, really, as a church family, for the sake of the gospel and the mission that Jesus has called us to. So if you prefer to give electronically and you're not already set up for like a recurring payment, you can text the link up on the screen and you can set up an electronic payment. We also have a box in the back that's got our logo in it right by the back wall. You'll see it on your way out. And if you prefer to give with a physical check or cash, you can drop it in there. That's great. We appreciate that as well. But we are so thankful for the faithful giving of our church membership as the Lord continues to provide for us and to work in us and among us and through us for his glory. Matt.
Good morning. It's nice to worship with you this morning, and for those of you who are joining us online, we're glad that you can be with us as well, virtually. If you've got your Bible with you, go with me to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8 is where we are going to be again today, and if you don't have a Bible with you, but you'd like to follow along with us, you should be able to grab one out of one of those chair racks in front of you and find where we're going to be on page 944 of those Bibles that are on the chair racks. Before we get started, I just want to express my gratitude and thankfulness to the Lord for starting to give health and strength to many of those in our church family who have been very seriously ill. We've got Debbie with us today. I know you love being pointed out, but we've got Debbie with us today. We're so glad. We've been praying for her and thankful that God is strengthening her. I got to see Bob Barker this week at his father's funeral, and he was able to actually speak at his father's funeral and be the same old Bob, but with a little bit of needed extra help with the breathing. But he is doing better and better, and there are several like Rita and others who have been recovering, and we are so thankful for that and so thankful that we are stair-stepping our way, hopefully, back towards some health and normalcy in our church. It's good to see all of you who have been able to come and gather with us today. I also want to say that apparently you have to have a 4x4 to get into our parking lot now. But I just want you to know, don't be doing the whole children of Israel thing. Oh, we wish we could go back to Egypt where we had the leeks and the garlics. I want you to remember that what you're seeing there is the promised land. And one day that dirt pile is going to be paved and it's going to be beautiful. And you are just going to glide through that thing. And it is going to be amazing. So they're working out there every day. And hopefully in the very near future, we will actually have a finished parking lot so that you do not have to buy a truck simply to attend Sunday morning services at our church. Thank you to all those who have been working in the parking crew for making sure that the cones are set up, making sure that we are directed. They've been playing Tetris out there, and it is definitely Tetris, but we're here, and we all found places to park, so thank you. All right, you should be in Romans chapter 8 if you intend on being there with us, and we'll get to those verses that we've been reading together each week in just a few moments. But I was reading recently about a man by the name of Ray Bruce. Ray Bruce was outside chopping wood in his home in the Vancouver area when he had a heart attack. He was rushed to the hospital, and as they were examining him and trying to save his life, they gave him the news that if he was going to actually need a life-saving heart transplant. Every year, thousands of people have their lives saved by organ donation. And even though thousands of people's lives are saved each year by these organ transplants, almost statistically speaking, one person every hour dies waiting for one. Ray Bruce was almost one of those statistics, but not for the usual reasons. Bruce had been waiting for 31 days for that call, the call when they would tell them that they had a heart for him. And after 31 days, the call finally came. The only problem was this: Ray Bruce didn't get the call. The doctors had a 12-hour window to get the procedure done, and the clock was ticking. The problem was that Ray Bruce was staying in the guest house with his wife of a family member, and they were in an area of Canada with very poor cell reception. Let me just pause the story there. Why in the world, Ray Bruce, are you in the middle of nowhere so that you can't get a phone call for a life-saving organ transplant? If I was told that my life depended on being at the hospital in time, I would be camping out in the hospital parking lot with my phone plugged into something, checking it every 5 minutes. But apparently, that wasn't his thing. He's out in the middle of nowhere with no phone reception. And with time running out, the hospital decided to get the Royal Canadian Mounted Police involved. When I was reading that part of the story, I got excited because I was imagining all these Mounties in red suit jackets riding horses to find him. Apparently, it doesn't work that way. I thought all Mounties rode horses. They don't. But this Mountie took it to heart, and he starts trying to figure out where this guy is. He starts calling family members. They eventually locate where he is. He drives out there, and by the time he gets out to the house where Bruce is staying, it's midnight. The house is behind a gate and a wall. He can't get in, and so he decides that he's going to turn on his sirens and his lights, and he's going to try to wake the family up. Problem is, apparently, the Bruce family, in addition to liking to be in the middle of nowhere with no self-reception, they are all sound sleepers. He succeeded, though, in waking up the neighbors. The neighbors, in turn, finally was able to reach Bruce's daughter, who at 1 a.m. was finally able to go out to the guest house and wake her father up to deliver him the great news that there was a new heart awaiting him. A missed call almost cost Ray Bruce his life. And today we're going to talk about God's call. The third link in what has been referred to by others as the golden chain of salvation that we see in Romans 8, verses 28 to 30. So what I want to do with us this morning is read those verses again before we jump into examining the link in this third chain. If you're there in Romans chapter 8, look with me now at verse 28. The Bible says this, "And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified." As I've said, five words here are five links in a golden chain that stretches all the way back into eternity past before any of us were even born. It winds its way into the present where we are born again, and then it extends all the way into the future where it secures us to the glories that await all those who come to God in faith. The first link in the chain we saw several weeks ago is God's act of foreknowing. And we've defined God's act of foreknowing as his active choice of committed love. Before any bit of this universe was created, God is able to contemplate or consider a people that is going to belong to him. And he chooses to set his love on them, which means if you have come to Christ in faith, God, you were in God's mind before anything was created. He had already decided to commit to you his love. God's act of foreknowing is followed by his act of predestination. While foreknowledge speaks of God's choice to love a people, predestination speaks of their destiny. It is the destiny that God has laid out for these people that he has chosen to love. And we saw in our text last week that God has predestined that all he loves are going to be totally conformed to the image of his son. What God plans on doing is restoring the image of himself that was lost at the very beginning. We talked last week about the fact that in the opening chapters of Genesis, God creates humanity, and he says that he has created them in his image, which means many things, but among them it means the fact that we reflect him in some way. That image of God was not destroyed by sin, but it was certainly broken. It was certainly corrupted. And what God plans to do in saving each one of us is not just to rescue us from death and hell, though he certainly intends to do that, but he also plans on restoring us, not simply to the place we were at the beginning, but to a place that is even better than we were at the beginning. That's God's act of predestination. Those two links in this golden chain do not simply occur in the past. These two links in the golden chain occur before there was such a thing as the past. These two links in the golden chain occur before time itself even exists, because God has existed outside of time for all of eternity. But now, we move along this length of chain to the third link, which is firmly situated within time. Those whom God foreknows, he predestines, and those who he predestined with certainty receive the call, life-saving heart transplant that God intends to give them. And so I want us to think for a few moments this morning about God's call. And we can speak about calling in a couple of different ways. The first way we can speak about it is with reference to what theologians often refer to as the general call. The general call is the preaching of the gospel to all people without distinction. And that's what the Bible, that's the task the Bible gives to us, to preach the gospel to all people. So the general call is the preaching of the gospel to all people, but it is a call that can be missed. It is a call that can be ignored. It is a call that can be rejected. It is a call that can be sent to voicemail, if you will. The general call is the call to repent and believe the gospel, regardless of who responds. And each week, whenever I preach, I deliver the general call, don't I? I deliver the general call of the gospel. In fact, I'll do it right now. The Bible tells us that every single one of us, without exception, are sinners. We are separated from God by our sin. We are deserving of His wrath, and our destiny is hell itself. But the Bible also gives us the good news that God sent His Son to offer Himself on the cross as a sacrifice for our sin. And the Bible tells us that this sacrifice for our sin that Jesus makes on the cross satisfies the wrath of God and makes a way for sinners to be forgiven, to be reconciled, to have their relationship with their Heavenly Father restored, and to have a new destiny, a destiny in which they experience the joys and the glories of being with God and receiving the inheritance that He has prepared for all of us for all eternity. That is the good news of the gospel this morning. That is the general call that I give each week. And I'm not just giving it as an example right now. I'm giving it for real. If you are here with us this morning, and if you are not a Christian, if you have never put your faith in Christ, then where you sit in your seat right now, you can repent of your sins, you can receive the good news of the gospel, you can put your faith in Christ, and you can be gloriously forgiven and transformed and restored. But the general call can be ignored. What that means, the sobering reality of that, is that week in and week out, I can preach the gospel. And there are people here who hear it again and again and again and hit send a voicemail. Ignore. Every week, there are people who hear the general call to repent and believe the gospel, but do not, for various reasons, put their faith in Jesus Christ. Jesus Himself told us to expect that this would be the case. Matthew chapter 22 and verse 14 says, in the words of Jesus, "Many are called, but few are chosen." Now you can see an example of the general call in Acts chapter 17. You can see how this works. In Acts chapter 17, the Apostle Paul stands up in the public square in Athens, in Greece. He stands up in a place called the Areopagus. He preaches the gospel to the people who are standing there, the crowd who is gathered around and is listening to him. And here's how he concludes that sermon. He says, "The times of ignorance God overlooked," this is Acts 17, verse 30, "the times of ignorance God overlooked, but now He commands all people everywhere to repent." That is a blanket general statement that applies to every single person without exception. God commands all people everywhere to repent. Why does he do that? Well, it's a warning because verse 31, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man, that's Christ, whom he has appointed. And of this, he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. So Paul concludes his message. It says, God commands all of you in the sound of my voice to repent and believe the gospel. But this invitation has a mixed response we see beginning in verse 32. There, the Bible tells us, now when they had heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked. But others said, we will hear you again about this. So Paul went out from their midst. Okay, this is the general call. There are people who hear the call to believe the gospel and say, nope. There are people who say, not today, not sure, you're crazy. There are people who respond in faith immediately, and there are people who say, I want to hear more about this. This happens whenever the gospel is shared, not simply when it's preached the way I do each Sunday morning, but when you share the word of Christ with somebody across the cubicle from you. The general call can be ignored. It does not cause what it calls a person to. The Bible states this in 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 4. It says, God our Savior desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. And we speak of this kind of statement as God's will of desire, but we often distinguish between God's will of desire and God's will of decree. There are all sorts of things that God desires to happen that do not, in fact, actually happen. One of the things that the Bible says, speaking to Christians, is that God's will is for every single one of us to abstain from sexual immorality. That's what God wants for every single one of us. Have every single one of us in this room abstained from sexual immorality of any form, any and every form this week? Of course we haven't. It's a statement of what it is, a statement of God's will of desire. That which God wants to happen and that which he ordains and decrees definitely happens, but the general call is not that. Now, the general call is extremely important, and we're going to come back to its importance in a little bit. The thing that you need to understand right now is that the general call does not accomplish what it requests. So in the second place, I want us to see a second kind of call, which is the kind of call that our text is speaking of when it says that we have been called by God. This call is referred to often as the effectual call or the effective call. What is the difference between a person who responds in repentance and faith to the preaching of the gospel and the person who doesn't? What is the difference between those two people? We might be tempted to locate that difference within the people themselves. We might too hastily conclude that the people who respond to the general call in the faith are the people who just get it. The people who have read the apologetics or the people who have heard a particularly good presentation of the gospel. The Bible tells us that any response of faith to the general call of the gospel is due to the work of God. Do you remember what we said last week? No one is able, morally speaking, spiritually speaking, no one is able to respond positively to the gospel because we are spiritually dead. The Bible tells us that we are dead in our trespasses and sins. And I said last week, great problem is that a corpse can't accept a cure. God has got to do something in us and through us to wake us up, to open our eyes, to shine the light of the glory of the gospel of Jesus Christ into our hearts, which is why we need God's effectual, effective call. It accomplishes what it asks. Here's how one theologian by the name of Matthew Barrett defines the effectual call. He says, "It is the particular call," referring to the same way, "is the inward spiritual call of God to the elect that is simultaneous with regeneration." Regeneration is that work of the Spirit which gives new spiritual life where there was spiritual death. "All those," Barrett goes on to say, "all those God has chosen in eternity are called particularly by God, and this call is effectual in its power and outcome. Through the call of God, a sinner's heart is regenerated and her will is liberated." That's a great definition of the effectual calling of God. And when you start reading through the New Testament, you'll notice that word popping up everywhere, God's call. It's kind of like when you get a new car and all of a sudden you see that there's 47,000 other people out there that have the same car as you, but you thought you had the only one. Once you get tuned into something, you start seeing it everywhere. And as you read through the New Testament, you're going to see the language of God's calling over and over again. Let me give you a couple of examples. The Bible says this in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 13 and 14. "But we ought always to give thanks to God for you, brothers beloved by the Lord, because God chose you as the first fruits to be saved through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth." Verse 14, "To this he called you through our gospel so that you may obtain the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ." Those two verses illustrate for us what we've been talking about. God foreknows and predestines and then calls. Well, here we have in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, he says, "You brothers beloved by the Lord, because God chose you as first fruits to be saved, and then based on that choice, he called you through our gospel." We see that choice enacted in time as a person believes the gospel and obtains the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. And remember, that links in with the end of this golden chain, because the Bible says, "Those whom he foreknew, he predestined and called and justified and what? Glorified." The chain is here as well. Let me give you another example. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9. The Bible says, "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." Verse after verse in the New Testament show us the glorious truth that God's people come when they're called. And it's a call you can't miss. In fact, as I've said, because we are spiritually dead, none of us, unless God did something in us, would ever answer the phone. That's what Jesus says in John chapter 6 and verse 44. He says this, "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day." Now, we need to understand what Jesus means here. When Jesus says, "No one can come to me unless the Father draws him," he is not saying that there are all these people clamoring to come to him, but they can't. What he's saying here, when he says, "No one can come," he is referring to people's moral ability. We are morally and spiritually dead. None of us have the capability of coming to God unless God calls us. Here's what happens when the Father draws or calls people to faith in Christ. John chapter 6, verses 37 to 40, Jesus says, "All that the Father gives me will come to me. And whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day." That, friends, is what you call security. The Father draws people to himself. He overcomes our inability to turn to him because he has chosen, before we ever existed, to set his eternal, enduring love on us, knowing exactly who we are. Let me give you a physical example of what this might look like spiritually. In John chapter 11, word reaches Jesus that a friend of his named Lazarus is about to die. Jesus intentionally, the Bible tells us, did not go to him to give Lazarus and his sisters, Mary and Martha, the miracle that they wanted, which had to be a pretty bitter pill to swallow when you think about it. Here you're some of Jesus' close friends. You've seen him heal all kinds of sick people that he didn't have this close relationship with. But when you call him and ask him to hustle and come over, all of a sudden he's busy. Well, Jesus shows up. Lazarus is dead. He's been in the ground, been in the tomb for 3 or 4 days at this point. And the Bible tells us this in John chapter 11 and verse 43, when Jesus tells his sister to remove the opening to the tomb, and she objects, but does so anyway. In verse 43 of John 11, it says, "When he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, 'Lazarus, come out!' The man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, 'Unbind him and let him go.'" When Jesus arrives, he raises Lazarus from the dead by commanding him, by calling to him to get up and walk out. The command would not be effective without the accompanying power to obey. Mary and Martha could have stood in front of Lazarus's tomb for days, listing out reasons why he should come forth. They could have stood in front of his tomb talking about the cool thing that we've got planned next week. You got to come to this. But you know what? Lazarus is not going to respond because he's dead. But when Jesus shows up, his call is accompanying by life-giving power. And when Lazarus hears Jesus' voice, he opens his eyes and stands up and walks out into the light. Alive. We're not able to come unless we're called by God, who awakens us and brings us to life, which is exactly what he does again and again and again. When I look at this room, I see dead people who have come to life. Resurrected people who are alive. And it's because of the work of God in Romans chapter 4 and verse 17, which says, God gives life to the dead and calls into existence things that don't exist. And we're almost done here this morning. But as we finish, I want to note a couple of things as we have talked about this doctrine of calling, God's act of calling, this third link in the golden chain in Romans chapter 8. The first thing that I want to point out is this: God ordains, God decrees, not only the ends, but the means. God ordains not only the ends, but also the means. And what I mean by that is that God decrees not only what is going to happen, but he also decrees how it's going to happen. He decrees the mechanism He decrees the mechanism by which that will happen. That's the way I was looking to say it. The Bible tells us this in Romans chapter 10 and verse 13, a verse that many of us have heard 100 times, for everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Okay, we believe that's true. Anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. But the Bible goes on to ask an important question in the verses that follow, because verse 14 of Romans 10 says this: how then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. But they have not all obeyed the gospel, for Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed what he has heard from us? So then, verse 17, the crucial verse, so faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. How does God call people to himself based on the verse we just read? It comes through hearing the word of Christ. And how do people generally hear the word of Christ? It's spoken to them. You know what that is? That's that general call. I told you it was important. Just because it is not accompanied by power, just because it does not accomplish what it asks, does not mean that it's not important. It is crucially important. How will they hear unless someone preaches? And the Bible tells us that God stoops to give this precious, incredible message through broken vessels, through jars of clay like me and you. We hold something of incalculable value. In fact, 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 20 says, therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. God uses people like me and you to issue the general call, and that is our only responsibility. We can't argue people into the faith. Now, let me be quick to say, that does not mean that the Christian faith is one that is totally irrational and totally unreasonable, and something that you just have to say, well, makes no sense, but here we go. The Bible doesn't treat us like that. It treats us like people that have brains and rational functions, because God created us to have those things. So it's not that there's any value in that, but many of us functionally act like if I'm going to share the gospel with a person, I better make sure that I can counter every single argument that's thrown my way, because if I win the argument, the person will be won to the Lord. It don't work like that. We can't argue people into the faith. We cannot manipulate people into the faith. We simply have the responsibility to be faithful, to do what God graciously allows us to do, and know that when we speak the word of the gospel and we issue the general call to your children or to your friends or to your neighbors or your coworkers, God is going to use what you do, and he is going to graciously call people from death to life. And he's going to let you play some kind of part in it. The second thing and last thing I want to point out in conclusion is that this is an incredibly encouraging link in the chain of your salvation. God's calling accomplishes what it asks. It is simply the enacting in time of God's choice before time. And this, friends, ought to fill you with a humble confidence. There's two words there, humble confidence. Humble because you came when you were called, which means you don't get to take any of the credit. Confident. Because this is one call you can't miss that offers gifts that you can't lose. Romans chapter 11, verse 29 says, "For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable." Which means they don't get taken back. They're irreversible. All of us, friends, are like Ray Bruce that I talked about at the beginning. All of us are in desperate need of a life-saving heart transplant. But no one ever misses God's call. And Jesus never loses any who answer. So let's pray and thank God for that this morning. Lord, as we read these things, we admit that you do work, as the scriptures say, in mysterious ways. Ways that are beyond our understanding. But Lord, we pray that you would help us to give you glory this morning for the humble confidence that we have in Christ. We thank you that those you've chosen to love never miss your call, never lose your gifts. And we pray that you would help us to be empowered with a newfound faithfulness and a newfound confidence in our speaking the good news to the people around us. May we do so recognizing the glorious privilege that you've given us. And may we do so with a freedom and confidence that as we are faithful, you will do what we cannot do. We thank you that you have called us to yourself in time and linked us to yourself with a chain that cannot be broken. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Just a few moments, we are going to share in the Lord's Supper together. And as we do so, I want to remind you that as we share Lord's Supper together, one of the things that we are doing is celebrating the call of God. How is it that sinful people can be have fellowship with God? It is through the work of Christ and through the actions of Christ in which he calls us to the table. And so we come to this table, virtually speaking this morning, we come to this table with a humble confidence. And you need to pray as you participate that you would come that way. Some of us come confidently, but without much humility. Our confidence may be based on the fact that, okay, we're taking the Lord's Supper today. I've obeyed pretty good this week. Feeling good about this. You need the humility. Some of us on the other side of the aisle feel the weight of our sin and the condemnation of our sin. And when you're feeling the condemnation of your sin so strongly, it is then that you need to ask yourself the question, in what is my confidence? Is my confidence in coming to the table in what I do or in what Jesus has done? We have been called the humble confidence to this table. And in being called to this table, we are recognizing that we have not only been called into fellowship with God and his Son and his Spirit, but we have also been called into fellowship with each other. And we are affirming those things. If you are with us this morning and you are not a Christian, we would ask you to refrain from sharing the Lord's Supper with us. We ask you to refrain from sharing in the Lord's Supper with us, not because we intend for this to be an exclusive club and we wish to exclude you, but because the Bible prescribes that those who share in the Lord's Supper be those who have been born again, those who have received that new heart transplant, those who have put their faith in the work of Christ. If you are not able to come up and take these elements this morning, you do not need to be ashamed of that. There will be others who don't, but here, this is something that we would like for you to do instead. What we would like for you to do instead is to consider the call of the gospel that has gone out this morning. To bow your head and close your eyes before the Lord and ask him questions about the state of your soul. Do you know and believe the gospel? And if you do not, find out with a desperate urgency today. Understand what that gospel is so that you can repent and believe as all people everywhere are commanded to repent and believe. That's what we want for you to do during this time. This is for Christians, those who have put their faith in Christ. And so here's the instructions. I believe Dwight is the person that's going to be dismissing us, and I know that because Dwight is standing up at the back. Then I got nervous that maybe he was just standing up in the back. So Dwight is going to be the person who is dismissing us. You can go ahead and come forward, Dwight, and while he's coming forward, I'll let you know that he's going to go down the center aisle. He's going to dismiss you by row. You're going to go outside, pick up the elements here in the baskets at the front, and then you are going to return the way you came so that none of you make a surprise appearance or knock the camera over for those who are joining us virtually today. So I'll read some scripture and pray in just a few moments, but right now I'm going to have Dwight go ahead and dismiss you by row. begin removing that clear plastic piece from the top to get the wafer out. The Bible says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 and 24. For I received from the Lord what was also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." You can begin removing that silver layer, taking care to point it away from you when you first open it. 1 Corinthians goes on to say this, "In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'" Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the bread and the cup, which represent your broken body and your shed blood. By taking these in our mouths and in our hands, we are acknowledging that we believe that we have responded in faith by your grace to your call, that we are in fellowship with you because of the work of Christ, and that you have called us to fellowship with one another around the table. We thank you for this love so amazing and so divine that it demands our soul, our lives, our all. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, we want to respond this morning singing a song that kind of gives voice to our experience of what we've heard this morning, that God has, like Lazarus, God has called us from the grave by name. He's raised us up from the dead and has breathed new resurrection life and resurrection power into us. So let's stand and let's sing together.
You called me from the grave by name. You called me out of all my shame. I see the old has passed away, the new has come. Now I have resurrection power, living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom. Sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness, you have given us freedom. I'm dressed in your royalty, your Holy Spirit lives in me. I see my past has given us freedom. You have given us freedom. My chains are gone. Freedom. You have given us freedom. You have given us freedom. Hallelujah. Now I have resurrection power, living on the inside, Jesus.
Amen. Well, as we close and we're sent out today, let me remind you of a couple announcements. First, next week, we plan to be back, Lord willing, to normal Sunday morning schedule. So that's two services at 9 and 10:45. We'll have Sunday school, nursery, children's Sunday school, and youth group Sunday school during the 9 o'clock service, nursery and community kids at 10:45. So Lord willing, everything resumes as normal next week. Thanks for your patience as we've navigated what kind of turned into like a little COVID outbreak in our church over the last month. But praise the Lord that we appear to be getting past that and headed back to normal. And then secondly, if you are new to Community Bible Church and you are interested in finding out more of what it means to be a member, at this church, we are hosting an exploring membership class that starts tonight at 6 o'clock here at the church. So it'll meet tonight and then again in 2 weeks on the 19th. It's not too late to be a part of that. If you are curious about our church, if you want some information, this class doesn't obligate you to join, but it's an important step if you do want to become a member of our church to be part of the class. So if you're here in person and you're interested in registering, you can stop by the connection desk on your way out. They'll get you ready to roll. And if you're at home, you can register via a link on our website or our app or on an email if you're receiving our church emails. But that's 6 o'clock tonight. We would love to have you. And let me send us out today with a benediction from Ephesians chapter 3. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Go in the grace of the Lord.